I'm Wade Price. Nobody is innocent. There are merely varying levels of guilt. Joining me today on VoxCast is the man who literally wrote the book on the Sisters of Battle. It's Codex Adeptus Sororitas background writer Alex Tuxford. Hello, Alex. Welcome back to VoxCast.
Thank you for having me back.
Was it about a year ago that we had you on the last time?
Round about that, I think, yeah.
So there's been a number of projects that you'll have worked on as part of your role in the 40K team up in the Warhammer studio.
Yes.
And we're going to talk quite extensively, I'd hope, today about Codex Adeptus Sororitas. That's quite a big deal.
Yeah, very big deal. Yeah. Very big undertaking, but one that was a real pleasure. Mm-hmm. Like everyone out in the community, we here at Games Workshop, we're looking forward to that as much as everyone else. We were given the challenge of knowing a bit more about it, obviously working from the ground up on the project, but actually seeing it out there in the world, seeing people being able to pick up their Adeptus Sororitas and engage with the new miniatures in the new book is, yeah, absolutely fantastic.
Great stuff. Glad to hear that. So I was going to check in on a number of the projects that you'd worked on before the Adeptus Sororitas Codex, because it was such, as you say, huge undertaking, really well supported with new miniatures kits and brand new representation of things that we're familiar with, and also things we'd never seen before. So you have to embed all of that and make that work seamlessly, make that accord with everything that we knew, and also set us up with expectations and hopes for the future. So what had been some of the other codexes that you'd worked on prior to Codex Adeptus Sororitas?
I worked on Chaos Knights, which is, I guess, quite far removed from Adeptus Sororitas in terms of who they are and what they do. Mm-hmm. I also worked on Astra Militarum a way back now. Blackstone Fortress was another one that I'd done a lot of work on as a whole setting unto itself within Warhammer 40,000. Certainly Adeptus Sororitas was one of those things where I'd always hoped one day, Alex, you'll get to work on this. And the fact that that time came around and I was the one that got to work on it was, really great. Very challenging, but very exciting in a number of different ways.
Mm. You just have to have faith and then it'll be rewarded.
Yeah, that's a good way of thinking of it, yeah.
I was thinking about the Chaos Knights Codex, as you say, very different. That was a huge amount of work as well, because there was no previous existing archetype in a codex form for that. We had a few ideas.
Absolutely. I mean, we had bits of background scattered throughout various things that we'd worked on. We knew that Chaos Knights existed, but we really hadn't taken the time yet to look at what they were in great detail. How do they function? Where do they come from? Mm. These sorts of questions. And it was those sorts of things that when you come to work on a codex, you get to answer. You have to answer a lot of them. You don't have to answer every question about a faction that you write about. But one of the responsibilities is certainly to make people feel like that faction really has a place within the Warhammer 40,000 galaxy, and that place isn't really going anywhere. They're there to stay. They're there to kick up a fuss and fight. And with Chaos Knights, that was a lot of fun. Just delving into some of the more horrid, corrupted ways that Imperial Knights might go bad, or the nobles that pilot them. Was one of those experiences where I really just got to open the floodgates on all the horrible ideas that you maybe have to keep to one side when working on other projects and just put them all on the page.
Do you have a big book of weird ideas you don't feel comfortable sharing with people apart from projects like this?
Yeah, sort of. Maybe not a book, but certainly some files on my computer where I put things that didn't quite make the cut for various reasons. Some of which were just too horrible, but there's an idea in there that's really good. It's just finding a way of presenting it in a constructive way rather than just a kind of gushing out of, this is something horrible, got to get it out of my brain and onto the page. Mm. Finding a place for those to reside when working on a book is a challenge, because it can't just be random ideas. We need to tell a story. We need to guide people through that experience of coming to understand who a faction is. And that's true for people who maybe never heard of this faction before, or a brand new to Warhammer 40,000. But it's also got to work for people who know Warhammer 40,000 intimately and know all the details and love delving deep into the lore, and finding that balance of introducing the faction for new readers and also giving plenty to go on for people who feel like they already have a connection to the faction. It's a challenging task, but it's also where a lot of the best ideas come from, is looking at different ways to look at the faction, not just presenting one viewpoint.
Mm-hmm. I guess you've got to recognize there'll be some people who identify with the Chaos Knights and don't just want to see them as the enemies of the Imperium, fine enemies they may be, but to see them from their perspective. Yeah.
And included within that are a lot of the Chaos Knights themselves who don't see them as having done something terrible. A lot of them feel justified in their decisions. Mm. From an Imperial standpoint, that justification is not valid. But that's where the interest really comes from, is that inherent tragedy that there aren't any easy answers or easy solutions in the 41st millennium. It's all shades of grey and differing degrees of tragedy and violence. Mm. and trying to find a path that makes sense and works for the individual, often in the case of anyone who's given themselves to chaos, is really exciting, because you can build in those reasons where you think, oh yeah, they've got a good point there, I can see why they did that. Mm. And then also showing the results of that type of thinking, that it can go horribly, horribly bad, or really well for the individual and horribly bad for everyone else. You can. It's so much territory to explore there that you can't fit it all in one book. So you have to kind of pick and choose what you want to show to guide people through that experience.
Yeah. And I guess there's an awareness, even though Codex Chaos Knights is the first of its name, you've worked on other Codex books that are the current edition of that faction, and the work has been done in the past to kind of set that expectation. And I guess when you're writing these new books, even if you can't fit all of the ideas in fully formed, you might put a few seeds in there that people might be able to look at.
Absolutely. And you want to put in seeds that can be taken forward in a number of different ways. Whenever, as a writer, whenever you work on something, there's a little bit in the back of your head where you think, well, next time around that I get to revisit this faction or this character, I have these ideas of what I would like to do with them. But it may be that someone else ends up working on that material before you. It might be in a different format. It might be something like a Black Library novel or something ties into work that you've done. And really, to make that work, is you've got to leave everything as open as you can, without making it feel like there's just no path forward. You've got to kind of guide people towards directions that a faction could be going, or certain elements within that faction might be trying different things, exploring different ideas. In the Chaos Knights, we had lots of ideas about the ways in which they turn and how that affects how the different households are acting now. And that both gives plenty of storytelling potential for where we can go in the future with them, but also for anyone out there who's collecting Chaos Knights, it gives them a good grounding of the types of stories they can tell with their own collection.
Yeah.
And gives them an opportunity to either follow along the path that we've set up, or to create their own path completely, and for those to fit seamlessly together. And that's really the goal, is to provide people the tools that they want to make their hobby experience as cool as it can be.
Mm-hmm. I guess the shades of grey is helpful in that regard, because you're not trying to set forces up as objectively good or evil, or bad guys or heroes. You might want to use a faction as the antagonist for a different faction for whatever reason, but they've all got their own motivations, whatever engagements or conflicts they're in. So yeah, that sets of shades of grey that allows other writers, I guess, to apply their perspectives to the story or the characters and present a new story with them that way.
Absolutely, and it allows you to set expectations and then sometimes upend those expectations. Mm. And it also allows you to bring factions together, cross paths. Often what happens when we start work on a new codex, we'll look through previous work that's been done on that faction, but also on other factions, looking for opportunities of, well, how can we show what it would be like when, say, Chaos Knights and Tau, what happens when they meet? Because the Tau, they don't have the same reaction as the Imperium to Chaos Knights. And yet at the same time, I'm sure it's not a particularly friendly interaction most of the time. And so that's an example of how there's not ever one solution for how a faction, a character, anything in 40K acts or what they do. It's all based on the circumstances that they're placed in, who they're faced with. And so that really is an endless set of possibilities. So really what the challenges with the Codex is setting up enough information that you can take those endless possibilities wherever you want to go, and giving place for us to revisit these factions at whatever point in the future we may revisit them, with somewhere that we can go to and continue their story, the journey of the characters, the evolution of that faction. We're setting it up now that we can continue going forward.
And were there any of the households in Codex Chaos Knights that appealed to you in particular? Do you have any favorites from that period?
Yeah, it's changed over time. It's interesting, when I was writing it, obviously this was before the Codex is out in the world, mm-hmm. and I think it's because I sit next to someone who's painting a bunch of Chaos Knights, James Gallagher, indeed. One of our games developers, and just the attention to detail and the little flourishes that he's put on his House Lycaris Chaos Knights has just made me go, okay, those are the ones that I like. But that's what's so cool about it, I think, is when I did my work on that, and then when you see other people taking that work and carrying on putting their own work into it, their own care and attention, telling their own stories, then all of a sudden I'm getting something out of that content that I didn't even create myself. It's James has gone off on his own journey telling his stories about these 5-6 knights, and I just get to sit back and enjoy.
Great stuff. Yeah, the Shades of Grey, I was thinking about Blackstone Fortress as well. The work that you did on that must have been quite helpful in establishing that while there might be parts of the Imperium that do see things in terms of black and white and other parts of the galaxy, it's actually a lot less clear-cut when you're in it yourself.
Yeah, and I think what Blackstone Fortress allowed us to do was have this very isolated setting, this little outpost in this dead area of the galaxy with this Blackstone Fortress in it, and there you have members of the Imperium, members of different Xenos races, and some Chaos elements, but not whole forces, just like a few very skilled, very adaptable individuals. And so seeing those characters with their values come face to face and have a common goal, it really shows you those gray areas where you might be doing what you think is right, but that's completely at odds with someone else who thinks that they're doing what is right. And that can happen within the Imperium, it can happen within one of the many, many sub-factions of the Imperium, and it happens in the Xenos factions and amongst Chaos as well. Chaos particularly, as you know, you get a the leader of a warband is the top dog until someone else comes along and says, well, I think I might be the top dog now, so let's have a little fight and see how that goes. But yeah, that was really cool, because in Blackstone Fortress we were able to put all of these very diverse characters in one setting where normally they'd be just killing each other off, but there's an external threat in this Blackstone Fortress which is the higher priority. So we'll all work together to sort out this one problem. Then we can go back to the standard affairs of just killing each other and arguing over principles that are thousands and thousands of years old.
So you got a chance to work on a couple of Ministorum characters as part of Blackstone Fortress.
Taddeus the Purifier and Pius Vaughn. And I really enjoyed that. I always like when you get a chance to see the human aspect of Warhammer 40,000. When I was last on VoxCast, you asked me about what were my favorite factions to write for, and I believe at the time I'd said Astra Militarum and Chaos Demons. And the reason for that is I love Astra Militarum being actual humans, not post-humans, but just flesh and blood, like you or I, armed with las guns and given some very stern orders and some inspiring speeches, and then sent out to face the horrors of the galaxy. And yeah, being able to zoom in on human characters like this and see how they adapt to the horrors they face, but also in the case of Taddeus the Purifier and Pius Vaughn and Blackstone Fortress, really take those horrors on board and embody that horror, becoming the puritanical firebrands who just go out and roast people unless they have given a very good reason not to. Yeah, it's being able to explore those extremes of humanity that are caused just by the circumstance that people are in, the lifetime of indoctrination, and a setting where the values that we hold as humans are kind of very, very far down the priority list. It is first humanity survives, Then maybe if you're lucky, your planet survives. And then if you're really lucky, you will survive. Mm. In that order.
The Imperium's hierarchy of needs
is quite
a big pyramid altogether. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
I hadn't really thought about it in those terms before.
But yeah, being able to zoom in on those people who are humans, but still have to struggle through these things, I always find really enjoyable. And it's actually why with Adeptus Sororitas, one of the most exciting things for me is I've always viewed the Adeptus Sororitas as the pinnacle of martial training for humans. Mm-hmm. You obviously have Adeptus Astartes and Adeptus Custodes, who are differing degrees of post-human super soldiers. But the Sororitas, I mean, sure, everyone in the 41st millennium might have some odd augmatics or, you know, the odd bit of bionic something here and there. But, you know, apart from that, they're humans. And they're just trained to such a phenomenal degree. Completely honed their mind and their body and their way of thinking and their way of believing to be focused on this task of eradicating the enemies of the Emperor, upholding the faith in the Emperor, and casting aside all other fears and concerns to fulfill that one purpose. And that, being able to see them achieve that to such a high degree and to be the threat and the presence that they are in the 41st millennia is really fun. It's quite scary at times just seeing the extents to which humanity can go and to write that down, but it's also a real enjoyable experience to flesh out what humans are capable of.
Yeah. I think that's part of the reason why people have been so excited to see the Adeptus Sororitas, because it's another complexion, another part of humanity's fight against everything that humanity is fighting against. And you kind of need space marines to keep the Imperium going, but they're few and far between, this we know, and there's the Astra Militarum thrown into all of those engagements. But it's good to be reminded of the different faces of humanity that are fighting the wars and the different armies that the Imperium has and the roles that they have, I guess. So for anyone who's not really familiar, what would you say the role of the Adeptus Sororitas is, and what was your objective when writing the background for them?
So their role is essentially to be the militant arm of the ecclesiarchy. Now, within the Adeptus Sororitas, there are militant orders and non-militant orders, and the Sororitas perform all manner of duties throughout the Imperium and for the ecclesiarchy that aren't directly military-based. But within the ecclesiarchy, there's a whole hierarchy of priests that fulfill all sorts of different functions around the galaxy, from converting human civilizations that have been found recently and ensuring that the faith on any given planet is pursued in the correct way, whereas the Sororitas are kind of the giant stick that if you don't do this, you're going to get whacked. And it's not just the kind of stern overseers of humanity in cities and planets that are functioning well. It is the force that goes out to a world has been overtaken by orcs. Well, orcs don't worship the Emperor. That's bad. Roast them. Roast them now. Get them off there. And it's the active part of the ecclesiarchy that just goes out there, does all those nasty, horrible, and yet, at least from their perspective, entirely necessary things. And that's the really fun thing in exploring through the writing, is showing these acts of massive violence against their own people, like against human populations, and then pairing that against, well, if you don't have this, if you don't have the Adeptus Sororitas, if you don't have a force that's willing to do those things, to sacrifice the humans that make up the Imperium in order to save the Imperium, well, then we see how badly that can go. We see the different Chaos forces that the Chaos cults and gene stealer cults and all these other things that arise out of aberrant faith and aberrant practices, and that slight deviations now can lead to massive deviations in the future. And they are the force that kind of keeps humanity on that razor's edge. And while at the same time also being at the forefront of humanity's wars. Mm. And it's that dual kind of aspect of the Adeptus Sororitas of fighting for humanity's future whilst at the same time fighting to make sure that humanity doesn't crumble into what it had been in the past. It's you can kind of feel the challenge that they face, that the Adeptus Sororitas face, because they are humans. Mm-hmm. You were talking before about how you have Space Marines who are wholly dedicated to be this ultra elite strike force of warriors, and they're few and far between. And the Astra Militarum, thousands upon thousands of billions of soldiers spread out across the Imperium. And the Sororitas kind of sit somewhere in the middle in terms of how many of them there are and how elite they are. But it's not a sort of hierarchy. Like, is the situation bad enough that we call in the Space Marines? No. Is it, you know, widespread enough that we call in the Astra Militarum? No. The Sororitas in the middle. It doesn't work like that. It's the Sororitas kind of sit off to the side and fulfill a very specific purpose that isn't really fulfilled elsewhere in the Imperium. It's making sure that that faith in the Emperor is upheld, both at home and going forward, making sure there are no threats to that belief. With a few notable exceptions of the Adeptus Astartes and the Adeptus Mechanicus, where it's like, well, the Emperor says they're all right, so we'll let them have their weird beliefs and practices. But other than that, it's the Sororitas who keep everyone on the straight and narrow, for good or for bad.
I guess part of the tragedy of 40K is, as you mentioned, there's some aspects of the Imperium that don't necessarily have to pay any attention to the Adeptus Sororitas, or and they might be centrally controlled and organized, but there's still the opportunity for disagreements or schisms or miscommunications or things that stop all of the arms of the Imperium pulling together and resolving humanity's glorious future. There's always the scope for that never to come to pass, and the holy wars of the Adeptus Sororitas, they might prioritize certain conflicts above other lesser concerns that really might be a good source or a good place to send in some battle sisters to go and sort things out, but they might have different considerations. And that nature of who the different bodies answer to and what their instructions might be, that's part of the tragedy of 40K, that they never seem to quite get it all together.
Absolutely. But I also think it allows so much opportunity for different types of storytelling as well. The idea that on one war front you might send in your elite strike force of Space Marines because priority number one is these targets have to be eradicated, you know, send in the big guns, send in the Space Marines. Whereas if it's an area of a planet or of a system or of a subsector that is already starting to get corrupted, then what you need is not someone just to fix the problem of the people causing the corruption. You got to fix the corruption as well, and for that you send in your special highly elite sanctifying force of battle sisters who will blow the crap out of whoever's in front of them and sanctify that world for the Imperium again. And we spoke about in the Codex the idea that to the Adeptus Sororitas, the Imperium is the body of the Emperor and humanity is his blood. But the idea is that you can lose a few drops of blood if that's going to be better for your health overall. You know, the idea of leeches, blood draining, amputation, removing those bits that are imperiled for the sake of the whole and doing that ruthlessly. You know, that's something that the Sororitas do frighteningly well. And getting to see that, you know, fleshed out in the Codex for the first time, and can't even count the number of years, since we've last visited them. Getting to present that in all its glory, along with the new miniatures range and gorgeous new artwork and that sort of thing. It was an experience.
Reminding everyone as well how interconnected the Imperium is, in the same way that the Adeptus Mechanicus books remind us nothing works without tech priests. Tech priests are everywhere to make everything work because they have that monopoly on technology. There are battle sisters and ecclesiastical representatives probably seated in lots of different Imperial armies, lots of different Imperial worlds. They are necessary to enforce the Imperial religion and keep all that stuff running. So to be reminded of, again, storytelling opportunities, as you say, it's not necessarily always huge, massed, pitched battle armies fighting one another, but they are seeded in lots of different Imperial forces.
Like there certainly are those battles, and it's all the steps that go into them and that come out of them that the Sororitas allow for completely different storytelling opportunities. Particularly through like the non-militant orders, like the Ordos Famulus, who kind of work as diplomats and go-betweens through the upper echelons of Imperial society, the planetary governors, who we also always view a little bit suspiciously because they have so much power and are so like are in the prime position that if they were corrupted, whole planets that might be important manufacturing hubs or agri worlds can go like that. And so having these Adeptus Sororitas seeded throughout, you know, watching what's happening, watching what's going on between these aristocrats, reporting back to their superiors up the chain. And if things go too far in one direction or the other, well, you've got a whole militant wing that you can bring in who can have some stern words to those people, usually at the end of a bolt pistol, which is usually fired during the conversation.
And the Hospitaller Order as well, that's always seemed like a great feature of the wider Imperium, that you've got those, I guess, the imagery of wartime nurses and the wounded soldiers being tended, that you don't necessarily have medics of the guard looking after the guardsmen.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think they're certainly in the miniature, a lot of inspiration taken from the real life situations that we've seen in like photos and history books of these battlefront triage centers where you have doctors and nurses and medical staff in horrible conditions sawing their way through people to try and keep them alive or do what they can. And yeah, we have that in the Hospitaller Order, in the Sisters Hospitaller, who go out and do this, not just for the Adeptus Sororitas, but as you say, for other branches of the Imperium. But they kind of, rather than being someone who's out of place on the front lines, that's kind of what they're designed for. You know, they've
got power armor.
Trained in, yeah, using power armor, and they can fight, you know, they've still gone through the Scholar Progenium, still trained in like the martial arts of the Daughters of the Emperor. Like all of this history of military training is built into them. So while they are superb medical personnel, they can hold their own as well. And I think that's really, really fun. Putting almost a job that we can relate to in our own experience, but then saying, oh, but if you have this job in the 41st millennium, you're also going to have to stab people and your bone sore. Feel free to use that on someone's face if they come charging at you. Yeah, it's really fun taking something that is quite identifiable and then putting those grim, dark twists on it and seeing where that takes you. Yeah, I think there's a bit in the Codex about digging living munitions out of like people's guts and stuff. And then you can imagine patching them up and saying, all right, go back, fight, you know.
Yeah. No fleshborer beetles in you anymore. You're fine. Yeah. Just walk
we're,
it up.
We're out of lollipops, sorry. Get back to it.
You have been very brave. Yeah. Get back on it. So when starting work on something like Codex Adeptus Sororitas, knowing everything that's going to be part of that range and release, what were your objectives as the background writer, and how did you start going about identifying what you wanted to do with the Adeptus Sororitas book that was different from other Imperial codexes?
I think really the goal was to, since we hadn't seen the Adeptus Sororitas in a dedicated codex like this for such a long time, it was our chance to show what are the Adeptus Sororitas doing, what is their faction like in the Era Indomitus, the time in Warhammer 40,000 universe that's after the opening of the Great Rift and after Gilliman has launched the Indomitus Crusade. What does that mean for this group of super faithful, fanatic soldiers? How are they reacting to that? And we got to really show that the Adeptus Sororitas, they're not just the kind of home guard. There have been times in the past where we have shown the Adeptus Sororitas, they are protecting their shrine worlds and preserving the Imperial faith within the Imperium. And this codex gave us a chance to show the flip side of that when they are out on these wars of faith, which we've known that they've been doing for thousands of years. What does that look like? What are their goals in these wars of faith? And how do those goals align with the rest of the Imperium? When you've got someone leading an Imperium-wide crusade, the Indomitus Crusade, but that guy doesn't have the same faith that you and everyone else in the Imperium should have, how do you deal with that? And in a lot of cases, it's questions that we can pose rather than answers. You know, we know that the Adeptus Sororitas have and do fight along the Adeptus Astartes. There is an understanding that their totalitarian idea of what the imperial creed, the faith and the godhood of the emperor is, doesn't apply to the Adeptus Astartes, and that's fine. They just kind of sit in an odd category off here to the side, but because the Adeptus Astartes were created by the emperor and you know, his genes, genetic descendants, I guess, then, you know, what must that be like for the sororitas? Mm. It would be like in other sort of religious systems, some sort of almost supernatural or divinely inspired beings that you're fighting alongside, and yet these beings don't believe the same thing as you. But I also think that's really cool because it gets to show the immovability of the faith that the Adeptus Sororitas have. It's not, that bit is not a question to them.
It's a great test of faith.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's the immovable object, and then everything else around it can adjust.
Mm-hmm.
And seeing how they put that into practice and really go out on the offensive when times are bad, and when there's horrible things happening across the galaxy, showing them band together to defend areas like, in the Codex we talk about the Order of the Ebon Chalice, preventing the Black Legion, like one of the inroads that the Black Legion was making sort of in the direction of Terra, while at the same time we talk about the Order of the Argent Shroud zipping around fighting whatever forces of Chaos or Xenos they can find during the upheaval and tumult after the galaxy has basically been split in two, and showing that not all of the Orders or all of the Adeptus Sororitas react in the same way or act in the same way going forward, but that all of their actions are informed by this one central idea, the idea that the Emperor of Mankind is a god and his will is made manifest through the Adeptus Sororitas and their actions. Mm. And just absolutely believing that, even in the face of overwhelming odds.
So the Space Marines inherit an awful lot of their cultures from, I guess, quirks of their Primarchs. Mm. And or quirks of their environment. So nature and nurture contributes to the makeup of Space Marines. What's the makeup of a Adeptus Sororitas order? How do culturally they differ from Space Marine chapters?
Yeah, so the orders are essentially, each of the orders is formed by the Ecclesiarch, but they were originally, the six original orders were led by the six matriarchs of the Adeptus Sororitas, and these are the six who went in and saw the Emperor during a time of great upheaval. And so you have Goj Van Dyer on one side and Sebastian Thor on the other side, and what would become the Adeptus Sororitas essentially had to make the call as to which of these should be the Ecclesiarch, which of these should be the God Emperor's representative for humanity. And six of these warriors went and were taken before the Emperor, and those are the six matriarchs. So each of the matriarchs has their own personality, their own proclivities and skills. Mina, who became the matriarch of the Bloody Rose, was known as the super aggressive, super combat melee, just juggernaut, essentially. Where someone like Saint Catherine was seen as the one who was always sacrificing for others. But what's really interesting with the matriarchs is that what we know about them and what the Adeptus Sororitas know about them is passed down through tradition, through their doctrines, through their practices, rather than an actual genetic descendancy as it is with the Space Marines. So they are still very much humans that they are modeling themselves afterwards. The ways that they fight, the different cultures that they have across the orders are based on these exemplary humans, who all of which became saints at some point. And the question as to what sainthood means for the Imperium, for a servant of the God Emperor, is one that we're still playing around with. Mm-hmm. When we present it, when we write about what sainthood is, it's one of the great joys we get to write about that from what the people who witness that see, without necessarily saying what the truth is.
Yeah.
And that's one of the really fun things to play around with the Sororitas, is they have these beliefs about the God Emperor acting in all these different ways and always keeping his watchful eye on them and intervening on their behalf and changing the course of battle and smiting their foes. And these things do happen, but the method by which they happen, the Sororitas believe it is an extension of their faith and his will. Other elements of the Imperium don't believe that so much, and Xenos factions and other factions certainly don't believe it, but it does happen. So it's fun playing around with, wait, was that that bolt shot, was it guided between these, you know, foes to hit that fuel tank and explode and destroy that whole battle line? Mm-hmm. Or was that one of those flukes of battle? And if you're one of the Sororitas, that's not a question. It is the Emperor intervening, and that's all that really matters from their perspective. Mm-hmm. So when writing about them, you really get to steer into that almost tunnel vision that the Sororitas have, where whatever happens, good or bad, it's the will of the Emperor. So do your part. Yeah. Yeah.
And how much of the character of the matriarchs and the major orders was already defined, and what did you pick apart to extrapolate and flesh them out?
There were bits of it that were already defined. We already had some ideas of how they were different from one another. The Argent Shroud, we'd talked about they based their actions on deeds, not words. And we knew that the Order of Our Martyred Lady, they had been fleshed out probably most of all in terms of what their character was and what typified a sister of the Order of Our Martyred Lady. But none of them, we hadn't kind of collated all that information into one place before, and for some of the other orders we hadn't done as much exploration up to this point. So it really was an opportunity to say, what have we said in the past? What are the shapes that these orders are currently? And how can we expand upon that and make them really unique? Not just in and of themselves, but for then the Ordos Minoris, the subsidiary orders that break away from them. What opportunities does it give to give them character? The Order of the Valorous Heart, they are kind of centered around the idea of suffering and the ability for them to endure any hardship because the Emperor gives them strength and because their matriarch was martyred so horribly, and they remember this experience through this long verse that they recite like every single day, which goes through all the stages of her torture and murder and all this horrible stuff. But they take that on board and say, well, if our matriarch could go through that, then so can we. And then going into their Ordos Minoris that have stemmed off this order, I believe it was the Order of the Wounded Heart, was one example that we put in the book as an example of this order who follows on from Valorous Heart, but they focus on this one verse that talks about degloving the hand. And So they continue to do that as like a rite or a kind of ceremonial way of connecting with their matriarch and feeling her pain whenever they pull the trigger with their raw and bloody hand within their power armor. But yeah, we really wanted to set up each of the orders so that they were not only had their own personality, their own culture, but also that anyone can take that ball and run with it. You know, they can either explore that order themselves and through their hobby collection, or create an Order Minoris that is spawned from that major order and has its own character that is somehow influenced by the major order. But yeah, it's always the case that you can't fit as much in the book as you would like to, but that's always kind of a good thing. Mm. Because otherwise, if I could write everything that I'd wanted to, I would have gotten every single detail about every single order, written it down in stone, and then it's set. Where it's always more exciting, I find, if you kind of define the rough shape of the order, give the kind of character the really important things that will always be the case, but then allow people the freedom to say, okay, well, in my collection I have this collection that's Order of the Sacred Rose, but I've always imagined them being part of this circumstance, or maybe they're consistently fighting against these enemies, so their culture has been adapted in this way. And yeah, it's really making it so that what we write in the book about these orders is the starting point rather than the end point.
As you say, asking questions in what you're writing, and I guess then hobbyists with their own collections can attempt to answer some of those questions.
Yeah.
And there is a great way of resolving conflict or disagreements of opinion in tabletop war games, and you can put your different armies together and decide how they would sort things out on the battlefields of the 41st millennium.
And it's absolutely the way you do it when you're writing, is that if you're writing ideas and then the people you're showing it to for peer review or your editors or the other people in the team who are working on that project alongside you, if they can see what you've written and that starts spawning ideas for them that you didn't have yourself, then you know you're in a good place, because ultimately that's the purpose of writing for these books, is to help inspire people to create their own narratives and have their own personality for their collection. It's just giving you that nudge in the right direction of what it should be for the sororitas in this case.
So are you happy that you're encouraging people to convert degloved battle sisters for their collections?
If you can go to all the time and trouble to model that, then yes.
Send pictures to Alex Tuxford. It's his responsibility. Yeah. It's a very elegant system, the way the Ordos Minoris all stem from the teachings of the matriarch of the major order, and I guess there's scope in the 41st millennium for a convent or an order to have lost something to history if you wanted to come up with a bit of an aberration.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
Less likely than Space Marine chapters that don't necessarily follow their ancestry all the way back. That seems more common.
Yeah, absolutely, and also because they are humans, and the fact that there are more of them than there are Space Marines, and in a lot of ways they could be very isolationist or have a very specific mission that they're going on, that really the door is open to take it in any direction that you want. We even talk about the fact that on the incredibly rare occasions that an element within the Adeptus Sororitas starts veering off the path of the Imperial Creed, there are people in the Adeptus Sororitas whose task it is to take them down. It's making sure that everything is accounted for, like how would the sororitas act in these different situations, without necessarily spelling it out in every instance, because then you just get a big list of things that they have done, and we could populate that list for the past 4,000, 5,000 years of their history.
You might struggle to write it in your lifetime, though.
Yeah, that's the thing, is you run out of space. And also, for me, that whenever approaching any project or any codex, the first step for me is always, what's the coolest thing about this faction? And for the sororitas, it was, they have this religious aspect to them, which, although present in some of the other factions, particularly in the Imperium, is a focal point for the sororitas. And then there's the idea of them being this ultra-trained elite force of humans, where every single one of them is like a warrior that could stand on their own and go toe-to-toe with some of the baddest people in the galaxy. Those were kind of the two pillars of, these are the cool things about this faction. And then as you start to work down from there and you start exploring more, you can identify other things that are cool to talk about, but you can never cover everything off, because you would literally just be writing the rest of your life and other people's lives. And in the Imperium, that sort of thing happens all the time. But in the real world, I don't have like a servo skull like keeping notes for me, so yeah.
Why not?
It's down at the moment. IT are sorting it out.
You need the Adeptus Mechanicus. Yeah. That's why all networked, all part of the greater Imperium, all working together. So something else that you got to create for this new codex were some named characters.
Yes.
It's been a long time since the Adeptus Sororitas have received any named characters.
Yeah, so we've had Celestine, the Living Saint, who's a... She's managed to stick around, always coming back.
Yeah.
Which was also fun to kind of revisit and see what her position is in the sororitas, because she's had some fairly substantial input in some of the events of late, the Terran Crusade that Gilliman went on, and being present on Cadia not too long before it fell and having quite an impact there. So it was really cool getting to revisit Celestine and show that the Adeptus Sororitas have been around. They've been involved in what's been going on. We just haven't perhaps shown the spotlight on them until now. And then we got to work on some new characters with gorgeous new miniatures. There's Juna Therusha, who's the Kenna Superior of the Order of Our Martyred Lady. and getting to see the head of that order, with a gorgeous miniature with a unique mode of transportation.
Indeed.
Which is the pulpit from St. Holland's Basilica, which is where she made a stand whilst a lot of death and mayhem was going on around her, choosing to recite a sermon to inspire those around her, and miraculously surviving, and the pulpit surviving when all else around it was destroyed. And so you think, well, this was obviously the will of the emperor that this survived. Strap some flamers on it and make it fly.
Yep.
This is where I am from now on.
That's also the will of the emperor.
Yeah.
Flamers on it, make it fly, yeah.
But I think, yeah, she manages to embody the notion of who the Order of Our Martyred Lady are, specifically within the Sororitas, so well. You know, she's on a very, very fancy lectern, you know, with giant statues all over it. So she's about oration, but also about burning people. And that kind of sums up the Order of Our Martyred Lady yep. pretty well. Very passionate. You know, don't mind a bit of fire.
So is she a bit of an exemplar of that?
Yeah, she's very much an exemplar. And I think the way that the way that we managed to show her in the book shows that she probably is an exemplar and something to aspire to for sisters within the Order of Our Martyred Lady. For anyone else, she might be a bit kind of fringe, but that's what's kind of cool, is she's an exemplar of that order rather than an exemplar for the Adeptus Sororitas as a whole. And then we've got another amazing new kit, which is the Triumph of Saint Catherine, which is sort of a character in that it has the remains of Catherine, one of the six matriarchs, who was the head of the Order of Our Martyred Lady, originally the Order of the Fiery Heart. And having a kit that contains like a funeral bier and then six attendants, all with their own regalia and simulacra of these famed relics held by the six matriarchs, it becomes like a centerpiece to any collection. And certainly when I first saw what the miniatures people were working on, it was like 30 seconds for head to explode and put it back together, then start thinking about how we approach this. But it was just such a different miniature.
How much longer did it take for the rules writers' heads to get put back together after they've seen it? Because it might have taken a little bit longer to get their heads around.
Yeah, yeah. We got editors to sweep that stuff up and jam it back together for them. You know, they're fine. No, I think, as is so often the case, when new miniatures comes out and we start seeing what the miniatures design team are working on, people gather around computers. Sometimes we get like renders of what they've been working on. And when the Triumph kit came out, people were just spending a little bit longer trying to take it and go, hang on. So it's a dead person and six other people all on one base moving along as a funeral procession. And we could notice that when we described it to people, people looked a little confused. And then when you showed them the miniature, you're like, oh, I get it.
And I guess things like that help you to help define the nature and the focus of the army, that this is an army that will conduct religious services on the battlefield.
Yeah.
Conducting a funeral procession. Most other armies wouldn't be doing that sort of thing while they're at war. But
absolutely.
That lets you know their character.
And the idea that this is not a funeral procession that is going from point A to point B. It is endless. Mm. This is a martyr, one of the most revered martyrs in all of the Imperium, Saint Catherine, and her actual remains are there, surrounded by canonesses superior of the Orders Pronatus, who are the non-militant orders who are tasked with looking after the relics and the treasures of the Imperium overall, but for the Sororitas in general, specifically, I should say. And yeah, each of them taking on the role of one of the matriarchs in a kind of a performative way, but very serious and solemn. And again, this is something that keys off real world cultural practices and religious ceremonies. The fact that people dress differently, they carry certain things that have a lot of relevance. The difference being, in this case, is that those things that they're carrying and what they're wearing are relics of immense power, even though they're kind of simulacra of the original relics held by the matriarchs, they are still items of immense power that can obliterate armies and inspire the sororities around them to new heights of vitriol. And yeah, it's just great working with something that is so different from what we're used to seeing, and yet fits so seamlessly with the notion of who the Adeptus Sororitas are. Of course you would have a funeral procession through the middle of the battle if the person who's died is important enough, and if they were a worthy enough servant of the God Emperor, because for them death isn't the end of the journey, you know. That's them you know, being taken up by the God Emperor for who knows what, but it inspires the faith of others, that idea that like a single spark can ignite an inferno that can rage forever. That's very much the notion for the Adeptus Sororitas.
Yes, as part of the wider armies of the Imperium, if there were Astra Militarum forces in that vicinity, that would be quite an impressive and impactful thing for them to be part of as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, you can imagine a lot of people in the Imperium would know of the Adeptus Sororitas, and they'd certainly have more of a presence than, say, the Adeptus Astartes across Imperial worlds, and having little outposts and cathedrums and that kind of thing. But to see one of their founders, essentially, and how much reverence is given to this martyr, but also the weird goings-on, like the funeral bier that Catherine is on has all sorts of technological things, but also religious iconography. And again, it brings up that idea of the crazy stuff that goes on around this, the fiery heart of Catherine that is still ensconced above her body that somehow still blasts out things. Is that a technological marvel? Is that a miracle? Is that the will of the God Emperor? If you're being burned by it, it probably doesn't matter at that time. But again, those are questions that we get to explore going forward. And yeah, different people can take their own interpretation of what it might be. And that's not necessarily wrong, because people within the 41st millennium also have different interpretations of what that is.
And are you working on a Sisters of Battle collection yourself? Is that something that you've
I got the launch set, and I've been like slowly like putting it together. But between like other projects and stuff, I'm appalled to say, like, I'm not even through like assembling it all yet. I'm super slow with that. But I've got my color scheme picked out and everything.
What are you going for?
So I'm gonna go for Ebon Chalice.
And
I like the kind of super hardline doctrine that the Ebon Chalice have. It's kind of like, if the Sororitas are the religious fanatics, the Ebon Chalice are the religious fanatics within that.
The ones the other ones think are a little bit full.
Yeah, like, ooh, go easier, but you know. They are the spiritual descendants of Alicia Dominica, the warrior who cut down Goj Vandaya and changed the course of the Imperium, for better or worse, forever.
Mm-hmm.
And the kind of the founder of the entire Adeptus Sororitas, effectively. And they've taken on board that they are the elite amongst the elite. And yeah, I think their dark color scheme looks really cool with like the armor and that kind of thing. Also gives a lot of opportunities on the miniatures for some of the more snarling faces to like really stand out. Some other people in the office who've been working on it are going for some of the nastier orders with lots of scarification and that kind of thing.
Degloved conversions.
Yeah, things like that. I kind of wanted to go down the austere kind of armor and presentation with very stern faces. But yeah, I'm still figuring out the exact color scheme that I'm going for. But okay. Ebon Chalice is certainly where I'm heading now.
Do you have any sense of how many new orders, minoris or non-militant, you came up with for this codex?
More than made it into the book, certainly. Okay. Yeah. It's always the case that you generate a bunch of ideas, and then the top whatever percentage of your ideas are the ones that make it in there. And that's how it always should be. You know, you should generate more ideas than you use. Certainly better than using more ideas than you've generated, because that starts to become repetitive and repetitive.
Yeah.
But when working on it, I think we came up with ideas for lots of different non-militant orders and militant orders, and you put some of those in there and you keep some of them in your back pocket for later. And you see if there's an opportunity to present them in the future, or if it's something that you want to take on board for your own hobby. But yeah, it's certainly something, as I've said before, that if I had double the space in that book, I would have filled it up just as easily and still had ideas of what to put in there, just because there's so much to be said about the sororities. And having not visited them for so long, I was champing at the bit to get it all down and, yeah, get it out there.
So for anyone who might be creating their own order, background-wise, colour scheme-wise, are there any useful principles, or how do you go about that process when you're creating a new order for the book? What's the process?
I think it depends really on how you approach your hobby. Like, if a lot of people want to start with colour scheme, other people want to look towards the rules and see what fits their play style. If you're coming at it from the sort of the background aspect of it first, the story, the culture of your order, I guess really the question is what do you want your sororities to be? Like, they are quite a monolithic entity in the Imperium. They don't have the same degree of diversity of presentation as something like the Astra Militarum, where the different worlds, the different regiments have completely different cultures. The sororities have been kind of funneled into this idea of the Daughters of the Emperor, the progenitors, the original kind of sect that morphed eventually into the Adeptus Sororitas. And so their various backgrounds and where they've come from in the Imperium is slightly put aside. But once they're in there, there's a lot of scope. We have like the Order of the Sacred Rose that are more kind of in line with how we might see religions in the real world, where it's reasonably positive and they are very strong in their faith, but that still gets weaponized and turned into a tool to smite the enemy. Then we've got all sorts of space for these Orders Minoris, where you can have something that is completely your own idea that you've come up with. The core thing, I think, for the sororitas is they are 100% bought into their convictions. And so long as you start with that, you can pretty much tell any story you want. You can theme it however you want. It's faith in the God Emperor and all else be damned. And so long as you've got that, you can go crazy.
I remember David Sanders in the studio. Did he write the rules for this code?
He did, yeah.
I remember him observing humorously the notion of what would be considered a virtue in the Ecclesiarchy, the Sororitas, and the notion of historical being named for virtues from our own history, and the notion of maybe sister intolerance.
We put that in the codex. So it was, he talked to me about this. He was very keen on the idea of, the virtues being shown in this codex to be not what we think of as virtues, but what the people in the 41st millennium think of as virtues. So we ended up telling a little story in the timeline section about an instance where the Order of the Ebon Chalice, orders exterminatus on this world for reasons that aren't clear to anyone on the world. Like, there's some religious texts that are being studied and word comes back to the Order of the Ebon Chalice and they go there and it's exterminatus. And the canonus is canonus intolerance, which they had a good reason. Maybe no one else agrees with why they did it. Maybe it was the wrong call, but they had a reason and they stuck to their conviction, and that the canonus was intolerant of any pleas for help or cries for mercy, because that's what's necessary from their perspective. That to them is the virtue.
They see it in black and white. It's easy for them.
Absolutely. So that's a really good example of something where it's familiar to a real world culture or set of beliefs, but it's not just taking that and putting power armor on it. It's taking what was the idea in someone's head that sort of formed that, and then put that into the head of someone whose life is about murder and battle and is completely 100% solely focused on this goal in their life of serving the God Emperor. Yeah, and it's always nice when there's still something recognizable in there, but it feels wholly of the setting that it's in.
Yeah.
So yeah, that would be my advice for anyone who wants to create stories for their Adeptus Sororitas, is what's the thing about them that you like that you can kind of relate to, your own life or history or something about the real world that you find interesting that you see in them, and then twist and distort that as much as you can and see what fun you can have with it. And yeah, for me, I always write stuff out, see if it works. Some of it will, some of it won't. You can go back and change it, you know. It's your hobby, it's your journey, you can play around with that, and yeah, see where it takes you.
And in the setting of the era Indomitus, what would you imagine most forces of Battle Sisters or containing Battle Sisters, who would they be fighting? What sort of battles do you imagine they're getting up to at the moment?
Well, I think one of the great things with the current setting of 40K is it's not always going to be the same answer. Like, it depends where you are in the galaxy. As we're seeing through the Psychic Awakening series, there are different areas in the Imperium that are facing very different threats from different forces, and that kind of informs what the Adeptus Sororitas would be doing as well. I think the general principle that guides them all is still the same. It's the Imperium must be maintained. Humanity must be maintained. Not for the sake of the Imperium or of humanity, but because that was the God Emperor's will. And it's interesting when you look at it that way, because it means any aspect of the Imperium or of humanity can be sacrificed to fulfill the ultimate goal of saving the whole. And when you look at it that way, that your life isn't really that important to the Sororitas, the collective good of the Imperium is what's their goal, it becomes one of those terrifying propositions of their allies who are fighting alongside them in the Indomitus Crusade. Probably great to have this really elite, really well equipped, like really dangerous fighting force on your side, but at the same time, you're not their end goal. Like, your survival is not their goal. You are a tool to be used in the ultimate goal of making the God Emperor's will manifest across the galaxy. And that's quite a terrifying thought, I think.
Yeah, because you can never really understand or engage with that. They're never really going to treat you as an equal
and
sort of dialogue.
And you certainly can't question it. Nope. Because if you start questioning it, that's probably grounds for you
that's
going
heresy.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, some sort of heresy.
And it's, yeah, that notion that, you know, if you're not in the Sororitas, but somewhere else in the Imperium, one of the greatest assets you have is this fighting force, who also, at the turn of a hat, could show up to your planet and say, four people on this planet have been doing some really horrible stuff. Just to be safe, you're all going to die. But don't worry, we're not angry at you, but you are going to die.
And it's for your own good.
Yeah.
And you're welcome.
And also the fact that they're probably right, at least to a certain degree, and or at least arguably. Mm. And yeah, that's what's really fun with them, being that double-edged sword. For me, it's looking back to the moment that Alicia Dominica strikes down Goj Vandaya. Is she was his bodyguard, she was his protector, and yet at the same time, if she identified he is not the rightful servant to the God Emperor, that same sword strikes him down. And that's really what the Sororitas are.
Mm-hmm.
They are the defenders of humanity, and the cauterizing torch that burns all the horrific stuff out of humanity, you know. Yeah, like the doctors of old who save your life, but it's a horrible, horrible experience going to the old sawbones. Mm-hmm. That really is them. They are there to keep the Imperium, to keep humanity alive, but their methods are not pleasant. But they are probably necessary.
And a grim reminder that the future offered by the Chaos Gods if they take over, or the future promised by the Imperium, neither of them we'd probably willingly pick at this point in our lives. And to know that the Adeptus Sororitas are pursuing everything they're doing in accordance with their goals, well, their goals sound a bit terrifying and scary, but the alternative is absolute madness on a galaxy consumed by the Chaos Gods. That's Warhammer 40,000. That's why we love it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Great stuff. Well, thank you very much for coming on today, Alex, taking the time to share your thoughts on the Adeptus Sororitas.
Thank you for having me on again. It was
bring
great.
You back again.
Yeah.